In this lecture, we'll be looking at script and story structure. Now, when we break this down and kind of how we look at this, this is kind of the prelude to your final project. Well, each part of the semester has been building up to what you're going to be doing at the end. On the production side, this is really your pre-production start. So the script is going to be the writing of the story and then putting it in the appropriate format. All stories start with a script, all films start with a script, and so this is your introduction to that. So for your final project, you're actually going to be writing a fictional story. We're not going to be doing a documentary or anything like that. Now, fictional films have been popular since about the 1890s. Film is a text that communicates meaning. So when you think of film itself, you know, we've been talking about what things mean and how they look, and all that conveys things to the audience. It has to be relevant to the time it was created in, and that is paramount to anything. Even if it's a historical piece, the themes have to connect to a modern audience or the film will fail. So when you look at older films, a lot of times you'll have an issue where you're trying to connect with the story or even the characters and you just don't. And the reason you don't is because, well, it's not relevant to you. The themes may not be relevant to you. But when you look at, sometimes you'll get, you know, these films that you go back and you rewatch. I'll use a film like Elysium as an example. It's a science fiction film starring Matt Damon. That actually has a lot of relevance more today at the recording of this lecture in 2019 than it did when the film actually came out. So sometimes you can strike that lightning in a bottle, but typically you're going to look at films as a product of the time period that they're created in. That's why when you look at, you know, Looney Tunes cartoons today, they're going to have like a warning prior to the actual film will play, because it was a product of that time period. So viewpoints on race, religion, and society were different. So as you start to kind of, you know, think of your film and your story idea, just keep that in mind that, you know, as you write it, it's going to be reflecting where you're at this point in time. So as I stated, the screenplay is where it all starts. This is also known as the script. It's the blueprint for what we see on screen. The script provides us with a number of different things. One, it provides us with the setting, you know, the location that the action is taking place. This comes across in the slug line and the description of the action portion of the script. Now, while I talk about these things, they're not going to be on screen, obviously, because of the slide, but in the next slide, we'll be looking specifically at script format, and you'll see where these, you know, pieces and parts all come into play. Action is what the characters are doing and how they are moving through a scene. Dialogue, who is saying what and to whom are they saying it. Transitions, how a scene transitions to another. You know, going back to that editing lecture, are we going to be dissolving to something or cutting to something? Are we going to be fading in or out? Those are all examples of transitions. Character descriptions, these are usually one or two sentences that help describe the general characteristics of the character, and it can help with casting decisions. The narrative, the story we track to its logical and hopefully satisfying conclusion, and then time, this can also be indicated in the slug line or the action description. So time can be indicated by morning, day, night, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, later, moments later, continuous. There are a lot of different time indicators that you can use when writing the script. Scripts are frequently revised before and during production, and some of those reasons for revision may be budget issues. You know, you run out of money, and then you have to go ahead and rewrite the script to fit your new budget. This happened in the Thomas Jane Punisher film that came out in the 2000s, where they wanted to do this great opening in, I believe it was in Iraq, if I'm remembering properly. And it was going to give you kind of a little bit of insight into why he is the way he is. Unfortunately, the studio wouldn't give them money to shoot it, so obviously that had to be kind of cut out of the script. Story incongruities, things that don't line up in a story. You know, you'll hear about films going and doing reshoots after production's been finished. That's always budgeted into the film itself to go do reshoots, and those reshoots sometimes are to fix any story incongruities. Change in casting. You know, sometimes an actor drops out of a role. Sometimes you have to recast it. Sometimes a film will test screen and they don't like a character, and they'll sometimes go back and reshoot with a different actor or actress. Believe it or not, it's more common than you realize. Change in location. Sometimes locations fall through. Weather may change the way that you shoot. or change your location. So those will all force you to rewrite the script. And then there are a lot of different reasons. The most common one that I come across, believe it or not, is you usually change in location, casting, or that an actor just can't say the line appropriately. So a lot of times while on set, I'll go ahead and revise the script or alter the script based around what the actor can actually say or do. And when I'm looking at doing things independently, you know, I want to be able to fit the role that I write to the actor as much as possible. But sometimes even through doing table reads and things like that, I don't truly realize that they're having issues with certain things until we actually get on set. And then I'll have to kind of revise the script. I always have my script with me. I've got a pen by my side, and I'll sit there and sometimes rewrite it, you know, take a 5 or 10 minute break, and I'll rewrite an entire scene just to make it easier for the actor to get through it. So when we look at script format, one of the things I advise and urge you to do is to either purchase a script writing software. I use Final Draft. They do have a student discount for it. Or you can use, I know Celtex is a common one that students will use. Just it helps you and aids you in kind of this very odd format that you see a script take place in. So when you look at it, it's not going to be centered on a page. It's going to be kind of off-centered. You're going to have things in different areas. And it's really important that you go ahead and you follow the script format. You know, it's one of the things that you'll be graded on when you turn in your actual script is how well formatted it is. So using a program like Word is not going to benefit you at all. So the script format, when we look at it, all scripts start with fade in. And this is a transition. Okay, so our fade in is how our script starts, and it is a transition that is left justified. Now, typically transitions are going to be right justified, and I actually urge students not to actually write in any transitions, because when you write in transitions, you're telling an editor how to do their job, and when you write, you want to write from a screenwriter's perspective. So you don't want to be telling the director how to do their job or the editor. But again, our script is going to start with fade in, okay? And then after that, you can see immediately I have this INT, car, evening. This is your slug line. So INT is for interior, EXT would be for exterior. So this is going to be your basic or your general location information. Anytime you change location, you want to go ahead and change your slug line. So in the case of this, this is just one page of a script, and when I actually go through and you guys watch the script writing lecture, I'll be talking more about how I write the script and where I'm changing my slug lines and why I'm changing it. The action section is right here. This is going to describe everything that your characters are doing. Okay, so this is shortly after your slug line. You can see that there's space justification after it. The other thing you should notice is that anytime you first mention a character, we're going to put their name in all caps. So you can see there, we have one mention of character, here another mention of character. So anytime we first mention a character, we're going to put it in all caps. So this just says, Joni sits quietly staring out the window. She looks exhausted, bags under her eyes, but a natural beauty about her. That's a nice, simple character description. Patrick is driving. He is slightly younger than Joni, but he doesn't look it. He too, I misspelled that, supposed to be looks tired, but not a physical tired, emotionally drained from thoughts of what is to come. So again, simple character descriptions. We know that they're both sitting in a car. It's evening. They're both tired. They're both kind of going on their way. Then we have our character name right here. This is what precedes our dialogue, which is right below it. Okay. Now, I also have here an indicator of what the actor should be doing as they're talking. So here, without taking focus off the road, Dad would be proud of you. Then we go to action. Joni continues staring out the window. Joni, and Mom? Patrick turns his attention to Joni, albeit briefly, then back to the road. Patrick, and again, here's our dialogue and character name right next to each other. Mom never liked doing it, but she understood Joni, did she? Patrick again turns his attention to Joni, whose gaze has yet to leave the window, this time slightly frustrated at the suggestion. He holds a beat. A beat is a moment, so he's going to take a brief pause, then back to the road ahead. Patrick, who'd you get? Joni turns her attention to the road and away from the window, eyes still not meeting Patrick. Lori. Patrick, mild laugh. You sure she's? Joni interrupts. She is. So as you can see, as the scene kind of plays out, it's just a dialogue scene. Nothing over the top going on, but slowly kind of dropping nuggets of story information. But the key things that we have to pay attention to here are the format itself. Again, starting at the top, we have our transition of fade in, okay? Our first slug line, interior, car, evening. We have our action section, and action is usually broken up per character, okay? So per character, whenever a character is doing something, that's going to be a paragraph. When another character does something, that's going to be a separate character. We have our character name prior to dialogue. And then here is a suggestion of line delivery. And then we can see the dialogue portion as well below it. Now, as you work through your script, anytime you change your location, that slug line is going to change. Anytime you are trying to break up action, you're going to break it up by character. And one of the things you want to do when you do basically a short film is you want to do your best to have more action than actual dialogue. You don't want a whole lot of explaining of what's going on. So as you can see here, I'm not telling you what they're doing or why they're doing it. They're just doing it. So we want our scripts to be action focused. And again, when you go into the how to write a script lecture, there'll be more information about why you write certain things the way that you write it and how you do it. It's basically going to be almost a live recording of me going through and writing a script so that you can kind of see why I do the things that I do within the script format and how it functions. Moving on from the script format, we need to talk a little bit about what story is, plot, spine, so that you can get a general idea of how you start to kind of frame out your story. So story contains implications of characters and motivation. So characters are going to be doing something that they are motivated to do. So it's either solving a problem, it is growing to be better. You know, drama films are all about a character changing by the end. Romantic comedies are about finding love. So when you start to look at just genre in general, you're going to start to understand really what the story is. Horror movies are surviving something. Science fiction is surviving usually some sort of a scientific advance or some sort of fiction based on science. Comedy, you can go a number of different ways. It's usually modern comedies, when I watch them, focus more on the family drama or the character drama, and then it's the kind of odd incidents and situations that happen in a character's life. Plot are incidents that reveal what happens in a drama. A story idea begins when a writer takes shine to a character, image, situation, notion, or whatever piques their interest. So you have story, which is your A storyline, so that's the thing that we're following. Plot are the little incidents that hang off. And one of the things you can kind of do as you start to understand and think about this is think of this as a spine. So the spine is that main storyline, that A storyline that we're tracking through to its conclusion. And then the plot points are the scenes and all the little things that kind of hang off it. So when you look at Jaws, we have the opening scene of Jaws, which is the attack on the girl at the beach, right? That lets us know there's a shark in the water. The next scene is we meet Brody in his house. That gives us background information on him. So that's, again, a plot incident off the main storyline, which is that there's a shark in the water. So when you look at films, you want to start kind of to break them down as what their A storyline is, their main storyline, what it is that we're watching and that the character needs to solve or figure out. And then we're going to have all these plot incidents that reveal what happens in a drama off of it. Now, when we talk about the three-act structure, it's going to become a little bit clearer as to what those very specific plot incidents are. B storylines within the spine are plot incidents that reveal character. These are usually your relationships with other characters or internal issues. So if, again, since I already mentioned Jaws, if you're looking at Jaws, you've got Brody's relationship with his family, with his wife, with his kids. You have Brody's relationship with the mayor of the town and the board. You have Brody's relationship with Hooper and Quint. Those are all B storylines that help you understand the characters more. Now, in a feature-length film, you're going to have lots of B storylines, but when you're doing a short, you're going to eliminate those B storylines and basically not have them because they're really not important. Again, when you write a short story, and one of the things you want to do as you write it and you start thinking about your short story is you want to keep it contained within literally like a 15-minute window of a character's life. Anything outside of that is going to get bogged down. So if you try and make it jump all over the place, you don't want to do that. So if you're making a 3 to 5 minute narrative, think of 3 to 5 minutes of a character's life. And when I, again, when I write this kind of script that I'm going to write for you guys and kind of go through it, I'm going to talk about how I frame this story that I came up with and how it fits within this kind of box of like 3 to 5 minutes of a character's life. The event is how it ends. This is tracking that A storyline to its logical and hopefully satisfying conclusion. So in the end of Jaws, you know, the satisfying conclusion is the destruction of the shark. It's pretty simple. If you watch something like E.T., the A storyline is a boy meets an alien, he helps him get off the planet. The logical, you know, event of that is helping him get off the planet. It's a pretty simple breakdown. So if you're overthinking your story, you want to be careful that you don't do that, okay? You want to keep it as simple as humanly possible. And we're going to talk about good story characteristics in the next lecture. But again, our event is how this story is going to end. Now, I'd already kind of mentioned briefly three-act structure. So the way a three-act structure breaks down and the way story structure breaks down in films is Act 1 is usually approximately a quarter of the runtime. Act 2 is approximately half of the runtime, so that's where a bulk of the information is going to be revealed. And Act 3 is approximately a quarter of the runtime. This structure is something that the audience is familiar and comfortable with. Anytime you watch something and once you get really familiar with your three-act structure, you're going to be able to pull it out real easily. So if you look at, I'll use a romantic comedy as example. Act 1 is going to be meeting our two protagonists, right? The two people are going to fall in love. At the end of Act 1 is where they usually meet. You know, there's a shift in status quo. Act 2 is going to be them developing the relationship. At the end of Act 2, the relationship falls apart. Act 3 is them getting back together. There is your simple romantic comedy structure breakdown in three acts. All genres are going to follow a very similar pattern, okay? So as you watch, you know, if you're interested in a specific genre, watch like 2 or 3 of those genre films back to back and try and break down how each of the acts functions and how each of the beats falls into almost the same spot. And again, the structure is something that, you know, we are familiar with and we are comfortable with. So like when you try and break from structure, the audience usually can disconnect. You know, we go to a horror movie to watch one character lose all their allies and have to face off some monster in the end. That's what horror is, you know. It's a very simple genre. So, in Act 1, these are your common beats that you're going to find within Act 1. We're going to have some sort of establishing scene, an action opener, or a narrative hook that's going to open up the movie. So it's the opening of Jaws. It's the opening of E.T., it's the opening of Star Wars, you know, the ships coming into frame. So you're going to use, you know, that opening scene or that establishing of the narrative hook to draw the audience in. Now, a lot of times you can do this and meet the hero or protagonist in the same breath. So meeting the hero or protagonist is a very important thing to happen in Act 1 because that's who we're going to identify with and follow. Now, when you look at a film like Star Wars, we actually don't meet Luke for a little while. We actually meet the villain prior to meeting him. Now, the introduction to the villain and the introduction of the problem may come towards the end of the first act. But what I want you to do is I want you to watch this opening scene from James Bond Spectre. In this scene, we're going to have this great establishing action opener, but we're also going to meet our hero and protagonist.
Where are you going?
I won't be long.
So in that scene, we get a nice establishing scene, kind of a little bit of an action opener, and it kind of establishes our narrative hook. We do meet our protagonist, so that's just, again, a good example of kind of how in one shot, and it is basically one shot throughout, that we can get a lot accomplished. Now, as Act 1 comes to its conclusion, we have what we call our first armature. This is our transition from Act 1 to Act 2. This is where the hero willingly accepts and takes on the problem, and there has to be some sort of change in your protagonist's status quo. Mythically, and the way this is looked at within mythology, is when you meet the hero in the ordinary world of the first act, and then all of a sudden something drastic is going to happen and pushes them into what they call the special world. So in Star Wars, it's the death of Uncle Owen and Aunt Beru that forced Luke to then go with Obi-Wan Kenobi. If you're looking at something like Jaws, it's the Sheriff Brody witnessing the attack on the Kitner kid. In E.T., it's Elliot meeting E.T. In Gremlins, it's Billy meeting Gizmo. So all of those are your kind of very simple and familiar kind of first armatures. So when you're looking at this in writing a short story, or doing a short film, you're going to want to look at your first act as just finding a way for us to kind of understand who the character is, and then we want to quickly start the story. So within like a minute or less, you're going to actually have that shift from Act 1 to Act 2. So that's where, when you're looking at a short, you're going to be introducing your hero protagonist and establishing scene, action, opener, all that's all going to happen in one fell swoop. The best way to kind of, you know, look at how you're going to shift from Act 1 to Act 2 in a short is really that's where you're going to introduce the problem. So that problem is that A storyline that we're going to be tracking to through to its logical conclusion. In this example from The Matrix, you can see this is the red pill, blue pill scene. And this is where we have Neo having to make an active decision as to whether or not he's going to go further down the rabbit hole and try and figure out what The Matrix actually is.
I am Morpheus.
It's an honor to meet you.
No. The honor is mine. Please, come. Sit. I imagine that right now you're feeling a bit like Alice, tumbling down the rabbit hole,
You could say that.
I can see it in your eyes. You have the look of a man who accepts what he sees because he is expecting to wake up. Ironically, this is not far from the truth. Do you believe in fate, Neo?
No.
Why not?
Because I don't like the idea that I'm not in control of my life.
I know exactly what you mean. Let me tell you why you're here. You're here because you know something. What you know you can't explain, but you feel it. You felt it your entire life, that there's something wrong with the world. You don't know what it is, but it's there, like a splinter in your mind, driving you. It is this feeling that has brought you to me. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Matrix.
Do you want to know what it is? The Matrix is everywhere. It is all around us. Even now, in this very room. You can see it when you look out your window, or when you turn on your television. You can feel it when you go to work, when you go to church, when you pay your taxes. It is the world that has been pulled over your eyes to blind you from the truth.
What truth?
That you are a slave, Neo. Like everyone else, you were born into bondage. Born into a prison that you cannot smell or taste or touch. A prison for your mind. Unfortunately, no one can be told what the Matrix is. You have to see it for yourself. This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to believe. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland, and I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. Remember, all I'm offering is the truth, nothing more. Follow me.
Now, traditional moments that we're going to see in Act 2, we're going to have that aftermath to the complication scene or that change in status quo. So how is our protagonist going to then react to this new world that they're either put in or this new situation that arises? We're also in a future going to get backstory to our hero and sometimes to our villain. We'll find out more about them through their relationships with other characters. They may talk about where they're from. They may talk about their family. We're going to have an attack on or by the hero. You may have moments dealing with B storylines. These are those love storylines, family storylines that we typically see pop up in a feature-length film. We'll have moments with our antagonist or our villain that will populate, you know, a good chunk of the second act. When you're looking at a thriller, one of the things that makes a thriller is the audience is given a window into the villain's life, so we get to see them. We get to see them interact with other people. We get to know who they are. So then all of a sudden at the end of the third act, when our hero finally confronts the villain, we know who the villain is, but the hero doesn't. So if you look at a film like Silence of the Lambs, for example, we know who Buffalo Bill is by the time that Clarice Starling gets to him. And when that happens, for the audience, that's what gives us the thrill, is we have the information that she does not. And in our second armature, the ending of Act 2, our hero needs to be defeated both literally or figuratively. When you look at the defeat of your hero, it can come in a lot of ways. It can come in horror films. It's usually the taking away of allies. You know, in Jaws, it's that the boat stops working. In E.T., and in the scene from E.T. that you'll see, it's the death of E.T. where E.T. passes on, and then it's Elliot's then reaction to that death. So it's really important that when you look at that second armature, that you find a way to kind of take every obstacle that your hero thought they had taken care of and take it away from them, and or put them in a situation where you don't think that they're going to escape, or you beat them down and break them, or you take away their allies. So how does this relate to writing a short film? Well, in the second act of a short film, what you're going to have is don't try and overcomplicate the scenarios and scenes. Typically, there's what we call three trials in the second act, where the hero will go through three tests. And then in between those tests, we're going to have then that backstory and those moments dealing with B storylines. So in a short film, what you're going to do is you're going to put three obstacles in front of the hero throughout Act 2. Now, these obstacles have to get more complicated as Act 2 progresses to get to that kind of second armature where the hero is really defeated, isolated, or alone. the escalation of the complications or obstacles is really important to flushing out and writing a good second act and making sure that you go ahead and end it with your hero being defeated. So if I'm writing a baseball story, okay, my second act may be three pitches, where a batter goes down 0-2 and maybe that third pitch is high and inside, where the batter then falls to the ground, kind of defeated. He's down in the count and almost got hit by the ball. That's a good way to kind of create defeat within a short story structure. But again, in this scene from E.T., this is the kind of end of Act 2 and kind of the start of Act 3, where we have the death of E.T.
Chris, I don't know how to feel. I can't feel anything anymore. Have you gone someplace else now? I believe in you all my life. Every day. E.T. I love you.
So in Act 3, this is where we're going to have our event, you know, how the story should end. This is where our A storyline needs to be solved. Our hero is going to defeat the antagonist. They're going to solve the problem. They're going to disarm the bomb. They're going to realize self-worth. So there's a lot of different A storylines. They're going to fall in love, you know, in a romantic comedy. There's a lot of different A storylines depending on genre that, you know, at this point we have to solve. Some other typical things that we'll see in Act 3 is that preparation for the climax. You see this a lot in action films, sometimes in drama. You know, when you look at a film like Rocky, you've got the montage sequence of the training that's going on. It's him getting prepared to go into this final fight. We're going to have any resolution of subplots. Those subplots are those B storylines or any kind of smaller storyline that develops throughout. So if you look at a film like Saving Private Ryan, there's a lot of subplots within that film. The story is about Saving Private Ryan. It's in the title. But there's a lot of subplots just amongst the unit, and those are all kind of resolved as we kind of move up to Act 3 and get into Act 3. We're going to have our ultimate climax. This is where our protagonist is going to face off against the problem or the villain or, you know, whatever it is that they're trying to figure out. And we can have different types of endings. We can have inconclusive endings that just kind of end and leave us guessing what happened. Sometimes those can be fun stories. One of my favorites is in the film Narc and in the film Rashomon, where we don't really know the truth as to what happened, and we're kind of left coming up with a conclusion ourselves. We can have pessimistic endings. This is an ending that is downtrodden or downbeat. And we can also have optimistic endings where everything's wrapped with a nice bow. Now, American audiences, culturally, we prefer to have an optimistic ending. We want to see the hero succeed. We want to see the protagonist win. We want to see the villain defeated. In the ending for Jaws, since I've shown a lot of Jaws and talked a lot about Jaws, it's one of my favorite endings. And obviously, the confrontation with the shark is to me, just so climactic. You know, you've got man against beast. The sheriff, Brody, is alone on the water. He hates the water. So there's a lot of things that kind of play into the, and then it's extremely dramatic with how it kind of builds up to this point with the oxygen tank in the mouth of the shark and then the explosion of the oxygen tank.
Show me the tank.
Blow up!
That does it for the first lecture on script and story. In this lecture, we went over script format. We went over story structure and plot and incidents and event. We talked about the three-act structure and traditional moments that happen in the three acts. Now you need to move on to lecture two on script and story, where we will talk about good story characteristics and ways we can come up with story ideas.